How's it going, guys? Welcome to FM Nation. It's Jamie here again. We're back for the second episode of the second season of the Parma Resurrection. Hopefully this season we will kind of make a start on resurrecting Parma, because last season we ultimately failed. I don't like to put it as bluntly as that, but I also don't like to cover up, sugarcoat things. We did fail. Because our aim was to get promoted, and we didn't. So, but in this episode, I'm going to go over a few things before we kick on with the first game of the season. Friendlies, pre-season. We'll go over quickly pre-season. We had a long pre-season because I've changed our tactics this season and our formations. Just to try and combat the kind of defensive mindedness of the Italian leagues. I've tried to come out with using a kind of high pressing counter attacking 4-4-2, and it seems to have worked over nearer the end of the pre-season. It seems to have worked quite well. So we had a long pre-season, so it was, if you're looking at it there, it was about a month and a half long, which isn't like unreasonably long, but that's a long pre-season. We had a lot of friendlies. We started off, we get these, I'll just quickly say actually, these, because, oh Jesus, what have I done there? These ones here, just before the Italian Cup game, because that was a game in the previous episode. These five games, these five friendlies were, these were all set up to generate a bit of money, just because we were in quite a bit of debt, and we have been since I kind of took over. Well, I think the debt's got worse since I took over, to be perfectly honest. So I'm kind of trying to do my bit to regenerate some money back. So yeah, these ones are just sell for that. But I put a post up on one of the Facebook groups that I'm on. I think it was FM Central, and on my Facebook page, Football Manager Nation. And somebody mentioned that why would you set up games against bigger teams like that in pre-season and take hammerings, get completely annihilated off your teams and put your team on a morale kind of downer, which is a fair point. But these games were made to try and generate some money. In hindsight, it probably didn't work out, because when we got to our first competitive match, which was the Coppa Italia qualifiers, ultimately we failed on that front, and we get beat off Alessandria 1-0 at home. But yeah, we get beat 4-1 against Lyon. Marseille, then 6-2 against Lyon, 3-0 against Basel, then 2-1 to Bari, who are in Serie B, and then 3-1 to Sampdoria, who are in Serie A. But as the pre-season went on, we gradually got better. And the pre-season training regime was all about fitness, because the tactics that I'm playing, and we will go over them later on, the tactics that we're playing this season require players to be really fit and have a high work rate. So I've put in a lot of friendlies. I had a long pre-season with a lot of onus on fitness, and then after the cup tie, we had a month in between the cup game and the start of the league season. So what I did was arranged some friendlies against lesser opposition, or lesser than the ones before. Then we went and played Treviso 5-0. Put a wee update about that on my Facebook page, 5-0. Very comfortable, and if you look at the match stats here, just on the left, we really dominated, and I was very happy with that performance, because it showed that we're getting the right, you know, performance. We're getting what we want out of the tactics. And then we went and beat Cynthia 6-1, who are a Serie D team. And although it was 50-50 possession-wise, we really dominated the match. They only had 2 shots on goal, 2 on target. We had 11 on target, scored 6 of them. So, Alessandria played them a friendly game because I knew they would be tough opposition, and they did prove to be. Although in the match we were leading for quite a long time, we scored straight after half time, and again they came out with that tactic, and we kind of just switched off a wee bit near the end of the second half, and we kind of just, it was somewhat friendly though, so I'm not too upset about it, but it seems as if these tactics might not be great against that tactic, but we'll find out. It might just be down to the players not being sharp, but we'll find out. Then we played Paris Saint-Germain reserves, beat them 2-0, goals from Carapi and Paolo Cannavaro. And this is, I was very happy about this because we dominated this game. Dominated it. And if you look at, where are they? Paris Saint-Germain reserves stats. They had quite a few first team players out. They had Kevin Trapp playing. They had Lucas Digne playing. Alexander Dragovic, who 23.5 million pounds centre half. They had Andres Cubas, Adrian Rabiot, I'm not too sure about who these guys are, Delgadillo, I think his name is. He's only 19, but he could walk into our team definitely. And here's a guy, Nicholas Audrin, who is a regen, and I'm pretty sure, no, I thought I put him on my shortlist because I thought I scouted him, but because he looks pretty good, he played well. He played the 6.5, but he started off with a good rating, and then the second half he kind of fell away a little bit. But he looked good in the first half to me, so I thought he was worth having a look at. He's going further. Then we played Lumezzane, 2-0 we beat them, and look at the stats there. Very, very happy with those stats. Let's see the formation. I think they played quite a defensive formation again. So, I mean, that's very defensive. You look at, they've got 5 at the back. Kind of, it's like a bank of 5 and then 3 and 2 almost. So it was a very defensive formation. And we, our high pressing kind of countered that pretty well. So I was happy with that. I was very happy, 70% possession and a lot of shots on target there. But we did kind of fall away a wee bit after. I made quite a lot of substitutions. We also had a missed penalty, but I made quite a lot of substitutions during the match as well. Because we were at one point in the match we were at 79% possession, and then I made half a squad's worth of substitutions, and that's when we fell away a wee bit, which isn't to be expected, I suppose. We then had, we were scheduled to play for Feralpi Salo on that Saturday, but we had a few players away on international duty, and we were offered the option of postponing the match, and I took that offer. And it was sort of being moved to from the Saturday to the Wednesday. So then I just arranged a friendly on the Thursday for against Koper, who are where they from? Czech? No, I thought they were from Czech Republic, they're from Slovenia. Won that 4-2. I mean, they had more possession, but we definitely dominated the match, I would say. 4-2, their 2 goals were kind of on the counter, kind of against her and I play a wee bit. So yeah, I've been happy with the pre-season, the way it went. Although it didn't start great, it went brilliant. It ended up going great. Although the opposition weren't kind of at the same standard as we were, some of them were a bit low standard. Although Paris Saint-Germain reserves had a couple of world class players in their team, continental class players in their team, and Alessandro beat us previously, and Limitani or Serie D. So, but Gopper, they're in the top flight in their country, I'm pretty sure. So yeah, they're in the same league as Maribor, so they're in the top flight. So yeah, I'm happy with the way the pre-season went. We'll quickly go over the transfers. I went over some of them in the past episode, but we'll just go over the ones that we've made since then, which has been quite a lot, to be fair. We've almost got a brand new squad. So I think the last one we mentioned was that was Andreo Gravelon. So we've got, we went and signed Marco Frediani. He's a kind of, he's an inside forward, but he's a good, he could probably play in the wing, as a winger or an inside forward, but it looks good as a, he could be like potentially an attacking midfield as well if we want to change our shape, and he could also fit in just on the right or left midfield, even though he doesn't say he's got that position on his belt, under his belt, he's got the attributes to be able to play it, so I'm not too worried about him not being a natural. He's got the attributes, so I'm sure he could do the job if asked, if called upon. We then signed Agostino Camigliano, centre defender. We got him on a free transfer, which is what we've really been restricted to transfers wise. We've not been able to pay for anybody, just because we're in debt and we didn't get a big transfer budget. So Agostino Camigliano, he's our centre defender. He's the, I did kind of bring him in as backup to like Cannavaro or Tonucci or even Ajeti, but he's came in and to be fair, he, over the pre-season, he impressed me more than what Cannavaro did. So I think he's going to maybe feature more than what I was expecting him to in edge on the season, because he has impressed me, to be fair. He took his chance when he was given it, so we'll see how he gets on in the competitive matches. We've got Christian D'Urso, who's a winger, young winger. He's got a lot of potential. Unfortunately, we'll get to it, but I didn't manage to get him. I don't think I managed to get him registered, just because we signed a lot of players and I completely forgot about the kind of 24 player limit on registration, and we just couldn't fit him into the team. But he does look like a good young prospect, and he'll definitely be in the team in the coming seasons. So I'm looking at maybe trying to get him out on loan to somebody, just to make sure his potential doesn't drop, his potential ability doesn't drop, and he's not stagnating and not getting games, and kind of, I don't want his progress to stall. So we're going to look to get him out on loan. We've got then Filippo Carraro, who's on loan from Carpi, and this came about because Carpi's manager, Cesare Prandelli, was talking about signing Insigne, our forward, Roberto Insigne, in the media, and he was speaking nicely about me, he was bigging me up a wee bit, he said he's got a good impression of me, etc. So I went and had a look, and I thought, well, maybe he's got some players that I could get on loan from him, maybe he's willing to give me a couple of young players on loan, and this guy kind of caught my attention a little bit, just because of his determination and his aggression, and he's got a fairly high work rate, natural fitness, passing, tackling. I thought he's a kind of battler in the midfield, and it's maybe something that we're going to need. We're playing this kind of high pressing formation. We're going to need players that can win the ball high up the park. So I think he's going to feature in the games this season. Quite a lot of games this season. We then signed Carmine Masullo, I think that's how you say it, on loan from Lazio. He's a left winger, and he's lightning, absolutely lightning, 17 acceleration, 16 pace, he's got a lot of stamina and fitness, so he's going to be able to get him down that line, you know. So he's pretty good, he's got high work rate as well, and a lot of aggression, which is good for kind of having you know players that are shutting your kind of high pressing, try to shut opponents down. So he'll feature a lot. I think he'll probably be in rotation with this guy Antonio Negro on loan from Napoli, who I quite prefer. Although his aggression is not as high, but he's got a lot of work rate, teamwork, you know. And he's still quick. He's not as quick, but he's quick. And he's got a lot of fitness. He's physically better. And he's technically a little bit better as well. So I think he'll probably start, but he will get rotated with Masullo. Brought in Lorenzo Libreri on loan. He's a right back from Carpi as well. He'll just be back up to Bandini. It's because we sold Alessandro Vinci, who is our other right back. Yeah, we sold him. We were getting 80 grand for him and he wasn't playing. So I thought, okay, his contract's running out at the end of the season as well. So I just thought we'll sell him, we'll get a bit of money on him. It'll help with the debt. We then signed two players from Fiorentina on loan, and it is players that were in desperate need of, really, which was a goalkeeper, Giacomo Satalino. Now, his star rating's not as good as the guys that we've got currently, because we've got Tornaghi, Bassi, and Zomers. But the reason I signed this guy is because he's got a lot of potential, right? And I know we've got him on loan, but if you look at his contract with Fiorentina runs out at the end of this season, which is the 2017-2018 season. His contract runs out at the end of this season. So I was thinking, if we can get him in and get him some games, and if he can perform well and he can show the right amount of progress, we might be able to snap him up for nothing. And it's a player that it's a goalkeeper that we can have in our team for a long time. These things like his positioning and his agility and things like that, these can all be worked on in training, so I'm not too worried about them, because he's only 18 years old and he's got a lot of potential, so he's got a lot of time to develop. So that was the reason I signed him. We then went and signed Marco Dabro, who I think is going to be absolutely fantastic for us. It's what we've been missing, really. He looks like an out-and-out goal scorer. He's not really got the pedigree, you know. He's not really got the history of it. But I think at this level, he's going to be good, just because of his attributes. He's 14 finishing, you know, he's 17 determination, 16 work rate, 13 off-the-ball movement, which is important, especially for a poacher. We'll get a lot of pace, acceleration, agility. I just think he ticks all the right boxes attributes wise for a poacher. His composure could be better, I suppose it could be better, but I think at this level he's gonna kill it at this level. I really do think so. So he's gonna be partnering with Roberto Insigne as a kind of false nine poacher partnership. Well, it'll be between Dabro and Francesco Forte, definitely. because Paponi's no longer in the picture. And I'll tell you why, because we sold him to Virtus and Terra for $4,000. That's because his contract was running out. And with the registration restrictions, I didn't see him getting a game for us anymore. I just didn't see him getting another contract at the end of the season. That was my main thing, is I didn't think he was going to get another contract with us, because although he was a top scorer, it wasn't quite enough. You know what I mean? It wasn't quite enough. I think we had to improve if we were going to move up this season. So we're trying to improve. So that's why I've let him go and try to bring in players who I think are going to be better. So I've got rid of him. Maronju, Shinetti. We mentioned him in the previous episode. Finchie, just we spoke about him. And Filippo Danai, a young player, kind of just, he's not really that good and his potential's not great, so it's not really worth talking about too much. So yeah, we'll have a look at who our squad is now. Salo, playing this defensive kind of setup, which is the usual, really. It's what I've been expecting, and it's what I've been preparing for all pre-season. So this is the formation that we're playing, 4-4-2. This is what we're going to go with this season. We're going to stick with it. Famale Ari could be better. It's accomplished, but it's alright. It's a high. It's 4-4-2, and what we're doing is we're playing with a high line here. And we are, so it's a structured team sheet, right? We want the way to play. I want it to have a structure to it. I don't want it to be, you know, tiki taka, everybody flying about and doing that, because playing against Italian teams like that, leaving people out of position, it can kind of, the way that they defend, they can hit you on the counter attack, and we're not Barcelona, so we can't play that way. So I'm looking to play structured. We're looking to play a high tempo when we get the ball, because we want to counter attack, so we want to do it as quick as possible. Playing fairly wide, just because when we get the ball, we want to be able to have any kind of width that can stretch a team. We don't want to be too wide, although we don't want to be too wide, because we still want to be kind of responsible defensively. If we play too wide when we're attacking and you get counter attacked, you know, you can be left wide open on a counter attack if you play too wide. So we'll play with a high defensive line, try to win the ball high up the park, which means we're going to have to play an offside trap, because we've not got overly quick defenders. We'll get closing down right up high, prevent shot goalkeeper distribution, because we want the goalkeeper to be playing long balls to us. Using tighter marking, we want to kind of get tight to our men, close them down, and stay on their feet, because we don't want to be getting silly red, yellows and red cards. When we get the ball, I'm going to change that. We don't want to be playing out of defence. That was a different kind of thing, because I was experimenting a wee bit in the last game, but so nothing really, no specification for build up really, other than not, we don't want to be going any specific direction, just whatever's the best avenue. We're going direct, because a little bit more direct, not route one quite, but a little bit more direct, because we do want to hit them on the counter, which we've got up here. Be more expressive in the final third when we're attacking. We want to work the ball into the box. And then we're looking to get players to run at defenders, because if we're counter attacking, you want to be able to run. Don't want them to be passing the ball about and slowing the play down if they don't have to. That's just we just want them to have to have the bravery and the aggression to take players on when they come one on one with a player. That's how you do counter attacks. You can be done through passing as well, I suppose, but you want to give them the freedom to be able to take players on, because we have got good attacking players. And then there's no any specific kind of stick to position or roam from position, because we're shutting players down, but we're also hitting a counter attack, so there's not one or the other really. That's what's been working so far in pre-season anyway. So I mean, we'll be working on it and tweaking it over time to suit, but we've got supporting fullbacks for when we win the ball back high up the park. We want the fullbacks to get them support a wee bit. We don't want them attacking, just to support, come up to kind of midfield and give possession options really. And we've got we're using a sweeper keeper as well, just because we're playing so high up the park. We want the keeper to be able to come off his line in case we do get counter attacked. So I'll send my assistant to that, and we will go and dominate the match. I'm just gonna tell them that we're favourites. Remind them that we're favourites to go, and Dabra will look to gain confidence and that. So we will get into the match then. See if we've got replays on. Yeah, I've got replays on, so we can watch some of the replays. The goal replays in 3D. Cause I know I don't really watch 3D, but I've been watching other YouTubers, and they seem to show some of them prefer to use 3D. I like the 2D part when I'm watching the game, when I'm playing it myself, but 3D replays for the goals seem to be pretty popular. So I'm going to go with that now and see how we got on with it. See if you like it, or you'd prefer me to watch the full game of 3D, let me know. Leave a wee comment in the bottom. So far we're doing alright. We've got a lot of the possession. We've got a wee highlight here. Donici heads clear. Cavagna plays to Savoni. To Romero, away to Tardini. Oh, and Bassi picks up. That's a wee bit fast, that, isn't it? Bassi plays long. Meloni wins it. Oh, Negro back into Savoni to Fabrice. But Insigne picks up. Where's he going to go with it? It gets through past the three guys. And can Dabro do anything with it? No. Caglione, that was a bit of a kerfuffle there. Insigne just kind of drifted by those three defenders there, but never managed to do anything with it, unfortunately. Back to Saparay. Negro is down a little bit, he's lost it. Romero back to Meloni. Meloni to Tantardini. Meloni to Savoni. Into Romero, and he plays Cesaretti in, the shot blocked. Romero to Tantardini. Romero, Cavagna, Savoni. It's a save by Bassi, and Saparetti clears. Well, it looks on the match stats like we are dominating, and that we're having more shots on target, but we're not getting anything from the highlights, unfortunately, which isn't a great sign, to be honest. I'm going to stick with it, but because I feel like when I make changes, they don't seem to work, so I'm just going to stick with it, I think. Alright, half time, and quite disappointing. First half, although we looked as if we dominated, the highlights really went to them there, didn't they? So I think we're gonna just do you know what, every time I give them a kick up the arse, they seem to not really do anything. I mean, it's they get the green kind of reaction, but positive reaction, but it doesn't really seem to work. What I'm going to try just as a change to see if they can see if it has a different effect, a better effect, I'm going to try and encourage them a wee bit and say we can still come out of this with a win today. But I'll say it passionately. Hopefully that can spur them on a wee bit. Yeah. Oh. Well. Okay. that was not what I was expecting. But hopefully, I mean, when it goes all green, sometimes it doesn't work anyway. So hopefully, that's not the thing that matters the most. Cavagna out way to Tantardini and to Salvoni. Cavagna. Nothing. Got Bandini here, over the top to Di Roberto. Nunzio Di Roberto, that's a shot and it's a save. Donucci picks it up. That's terrible. He's just giving them the ball back. That's a terrible pass. I hate when they do that. Terrible pass. There's a guy out wide and he's just hit it into nowhere. That's murder. Mardini to Fabrice to Savoni. Arana Lucci to Fabrice. Fabrice to Savoni to Cesaretti. Oh my god, they're going to score one of them, I tell you. They're going to score one of them. Oh, we can't keep giving them chances like that. Jesco Forte for Marco Dabro and Filippo Carraro on for Gasperoni. They were just the players with the lowest average, the lowest match rating, so I think a wee change was needed. Might try to change to kind of like a more possession based thing approach, because the direct approach doesn't seem to really be working. We've got Cesaretti here, Tantardini, Maloney. It's quite worrying actually that although we look to be dominating the stats, that all the highlights are going to these guys. Eventually they're going to put one of them away, I think, aren't they? Celia to Cavagna, Fabrice to Cesaretti, and there it is. That's a nightmare. This guy's been getting in behind our defence all day long. It's unbelievable. I don't know, I feel weird. It feels weird when you're dominating the stats, you know, it looks on the stats like you're dominating, but then highlights wise you've got nothing to show for it. Right, so I made some tactical changes there. We're going to go a wee bit more attacking, but we've got an injury, a slight injury. Got to get Calcagno on. We'll get Calcagno on for Fiordalino because he looks like he's carrying an injury. I can't believe this. Every single time we play, it's really starting to get to me. So that we can't play against a defensive formation. It's the curse of the recording. This is what it is. We keep getting beat off. We keep getting beat every time we record. It's a nightmare. It's so annoying. I played so well, you know. Played so well. According to the stats. They've just packed a box, though, haven't they? They've packed a box with players, and it's... Oh, please give us a goal here. Look, we've got a 6'6" guy in there and you can't even hit him. How can... You've got a guy at 6'6" in the box and nobody can put a cross into him. It's terrible. It's unacceptable. That's a nightmare. Terrible start to the season. Knocked out of the Italian Cup and lost our first game of the season. So, look at those stats. That annoys me. Really, really annoys me when you get those kind of stats. and then you can't win the match. So frustrating. Oh, if you don't laugh, you'll cry, really, won't you? Anyway, let's have a look at the... Well, where does it leave us in the league? 14th after one game, so we're actually in the relegation playoffs at the other end of the table. excuse me, laughing and coughing at the same time. So a defeat against Feralpi Salo, very disappointing there. I'm going to play Padova. I'm going to play Padova, play these games off screen, and we'll come back for the Reggiana game, because my birthday is on the 14th of October, and the Reggiana game is the 15th of October, so we'll come back for Football Manager birthday episode. It won't be my birthday in real life, but it will be it'll be the day after in the game, so we'll come back for a birthday episode against Reggiana. I'll play these games off screen. Hopefully we'll have this Reggiana episode up for the weekend. It is now Wednesday. Well, I'll be uploading this episode will be uploaded on a Wednesday. The Reggiana game will hopefully be uploaded for the weekend, either the Friday or the Saturday. So thanks for watching. Drop a wee like, please. Be much appreciated if you've not already done it. Subscribe to the channel. And if there's anything you want me to cover in the next episode, or you want to know anything, you want me to check up on any players or anything like that, drop a wee comment, and we'll have a look at it in the next episode. But until then, we'll see you in the next episode. Alright, follow me on Twitter and Facebook as well, the links are in the description. Bye bye.